Good morning. I first met our speaker today, Ben McBride, at a class that we were taking together. It's called the Master's Program. And I didn't know at the time when we first met who he was, or I'd never even heard of City Team, where he's the executive director. And as many of you know, over the past year, we were doing a needs assessment and deciding who to partner with in our compassion ministry. And we actually decided to partner with City Team Oakland. Part of the reason is a team of us went to City Team, and they're just down the street from the Oakland Police Department headquarters, and it's amazing what they've got as it relates to a homeless shelter, food kitchen, incredible programs for addiction recovery, just a wonderful, wonderful program. But what impressed us most was their heart for taking care of people that, quite frankly, a lot of us choose to avoid. But Ben's not here to talk so much about City Team. Earlier, as I got to know him better, I heard his story, and I just wanted everyone to hear it. And as the events in Ferguson began to unfold this summer, I just felt this prompting, we got to get Ben here to teach at Blue Oaks. And so my prayer this morning is that we start a new conversation about race and faith, at least in our little part of the world. So please join me in welcoming Ben McBride. Thanks.
All right, Blue Oaks, how we doing? All right. I'm from the land of oaks. You all are the Blue Oaks. So no one still has given me the tutorial of what makes you all so blue, but I'll be looking for the infomercial later. So good to be here with us and to kind of be a part of this conversation and just a time to think together, listen to God, and enjoy the worship. And so just good to be here. I'm going to start us off with a quick prayer, and then we'll just jump right into it. Lord, we just want to say thank you today, Lord, for being so good to us. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Like the scriptures say, if you hadn't been on our side, we would have been swallowed up in victory. Lord, we're thankful for how you've met us, how you continue to meet us. And today, as we take a few moments, Lord, to read your words, to think about your words, Lord, we pray that you would open up our minds to hear what it is that your spirit is saying to us as your church. And Lord, I ask that even in what I've prepared to share, Lord, would you pull that back and allow your voice to come forward in a strong way, that we would all be filled with the courage and the grace and the holy boldness to respond to what it is that you're calling us to do individually and collectively. Lord, we say thank you for all you continue to do in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Let me just set that here. Love is the only cement that can hold this broken community together. And when I am commanded to love, I am commanded to restore community, to resist injustice, and to meet the needs of my brother. Pastor Martin Luther King Jr. Said that quote 50, 60 years ago, and I always like to call him Pastor Martin Luther King Jr. because oftentimes when we think about him and the work that he's done, we think of him as a social activist, but Dr. King in his first posture was a pastor. And today we're going to have a little bit of some conversation to think about what is it that God might be calling us to do, to be agents of love and healing and reconciliation that can hold our broken community together. Let's go to our theme passage for today out of the Gospel of Matthew, the 5th chapter, and I'm going to begin at the 3rd verse. Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Jesus shows up in Roman-occupied Palestine, son of a journeyman from a little ghetto called Nazareth. And he shows up articulating this profound message that the kingdom of God is here. It's near. It's close to you. The Jews would have heard that understanding that the prophets had prophesied for hundreds of years that God was going to send one like the person who was going to come and who was going to bring the kingdom of God, the triumph of God, the rule, the reign, the victory of God, that one would come and bring that reality into their midst. And Jesus shows up and he says, I am here, the kingdom of God is here, or as I like to paraphrase it, the world that God is making is closer to you than it's ever been before. Jesus shows up, and many people were hearing this from their different postures. The Jews who were living on the underside of the Roman Empire would have heard that proclamation in one way. The God-fearers who were non-Jews yet were sympathetic to the Jews' way of life and also leaned into the practices of the synagogue and Judaism, they also heard that message, albeit from a different place. And the Roman soldiers who only heard that message out of necessity heard that gospel and that proclamation also from a different posture. One message being preached, but people hearing it in very different ways. On this Sunday, as we think about Dr. King's legacy and we think about the message of Jesus, one of the things I want to lift up is that God's got a dream for the world that's bigger than any dream that Dr. King had or any of us could ever dream. And it's going to take followers of Jesus to take courage to engage in the places in our world that are broken so we can be used as agents of healing and justice. So I want to first start off by having us talk a little bit about shoes. You see, Jesus shows up in Galilee as the physical manifestation of God in a very, very broken society. Oppression, occupation, classism, sexism, racism. But God shows up in the person of Jesus, putting on the proverbial shoes of humanity that he might redeem that which was lost. Now, as we think about being the peacemakers that Jesus calls for us to be in Matthew 5, we are called to be people who are willing to step into the shoes of others with whom we have reason to other or abstain from engagement with. As followers of Jesus, we're called to bridge the gap between the others and the groups that we belong to as we're filled with holy boldness to see with new eyes and listen with new ears. One of the things I didn't say as I started was 6 years ago, I was pastoring in the city of Oakland, and that was the year we had 140-something murders in the city. And I remember that day, our senior pastor said, let's just stretch our hands toward the east and pray that God stops the violence. And I remember that day going, there has to be something that God might call me to do besides just stretching my hands toward the east. For with a variety of different things happening, I ended up resigning my pastoral role and subsequently came to City Team. And I moved with my wife and my three daughters into what they were calling the kill zone of East Oakland at that time. And we moved in because I knew I needed to understand the violence. I needed to understand what it felt like to live in that community and in that circumstance. I was living in the suburbs of West Contra Costa County. And so we moved in there, and I felt like God told me, you're not going to hear any more about the gospel until you come listen to me there. And so we moved into that community, and it's been a ride, to say the least. But a big part of that also included me beginning to start to lead. I'm a part of a team that leads the violence reduction strategy in Oakland right now. And our first year had a 30% reduction in homicides. And this year, another 10% reduction in homicides. So lives are being saved and things are changing. But a part of that practice and a part of that reality was beginning to work with the police department. And for me, that wasn't just an easy relationship because of my own story. You see, we have to step into the shoes of other people in order to understand people's reality. I like the way C.S. Lewis says it. He says, what you see depends on where you're standing. Your perception has a lot to do with where you're standing. The only gun I've ever had pulled on me was by a San Francisco police officer when I was 18 years old. I was putting myself through college, got off my security guard job at night, was walking to the bus stop. It was about 1 o'clock in the morning, unmarked car comes up 3rd Street, driving up to people not dressed in uniform, jump out with guns drawn, tell me to get my effing hands up. My hands go up. At 18 years old, I'm standing there. I'm scared for my life because I realize in that moment that I can be shot and nobody will believe what has happened to me as I'm standing out there. Being scared, shaking, and afraid that I was getting ready to be killed. Told not to move and being afraid. Now, that story sits inside of a larger story in my family because my father grew up in the Jim Crow South during a very challenging time in American history. And he told me the story growing up of being 13 years old when Dr. King came to his school. And Dr. King came to train students in the student protest. And he took my dad and some other 13-year-old boys into the bathroom. And he showed them that the same water main that was going to the colored fountain and the white fountain was the same water. My dad said that was the first time he realized he was drinking the same thing as his white counterparts. So he has this mind-opening experience. And so they go and they participate in the training in the student assembly. And then they go out to participate with Dr. King in the protest. And out there, my dad is met by police officers who subsequently arrested both King and a lot of these young people, 13 years old, and put them inside the jail and pushed them into the jail tight and closed the door shut where these 13-year-old kids were crying and urinating and defecating on themselves because they were afraid, and the white police officer stood outside the cell and laughed at them. And so on this day where my dad had a very powerful, inspirational experience, he equally had one of the most painful experiences of his life. And then equally in our family story, you have my brother, Michael, who was a Bible college student at Bethany Bible College in Santa Cruz. And he was his pastor's aide, so he would drive up to San Jose where he went to church to change his pastor's colostomy bags, who had kidney failure. And as he was on his way home, he was stopped by some San Jose police officers who asked him if he had any weapons in the car. And my brother's not as diplomatic as I am. And he had, you know, a couple choice words and telling them, aren't you supposed to ask me for license and registration? And subsequently, they pulled him out of the car and began to frisk him. And my brother felt that he was being assaulted. And then they threw him to the ground. And as he was wrestling around with his arms, a gun was taken out and put to his head and told him to stop resisting. And they handcuffed my brother and they put him into the police car and they began to search his car. And as they opened it up, they found nothing but theology books and Bibles. And they realized that they were looking for Michael D. McBride, my brother's Michael T. McBride. And he had this painful experience. And so he sued the San Jose Police Department and he lost. And when he came out of the court case the day that there was no indictment of the officers, he came down the stairs and he saw the two officers there that had arrested him. And they looked at him and they smiled. And what did Mike remember? The same smile that my dad told us about 50 years ago when he was 13 years old. I say all that because when I began to engage in relationships with the police in Oakland, I had all the reasons to feel justified in my family story to say, I'm going to other you. I'm going to distrust you. I have a reason to fear you. I have a reason to call you something else, to dehumanize you. But that's exactly where I feel that the message of Jesus calls us to be peacemakers and different human beings. That forgiveness for the people of God and for the followers of Jesus is not something that's just casual or something that we just kind of put in our, Holy Spirit-filled satchel. But that forgiveness is something that takes a lot of inertia and something that we have to become engaged in that we might become peacemakers. We have to begin to step into the shoes of other people that we might be able to see their perspective so that we can join God as a peacemaker. We must be willing, as my friend J.R. Swigert says, that we must listen longer than feels comfortable and take in the stories of others that God might use us as agents of reconciliation. Paul tells the church in Corinth, even though I am free of the demands and expectations of everyone, I have voluntarily become a servant to any and all in order to reach a wide range of people, religious, non-religious, meticulous, moralist, loose-living, immoralist, the defeated, the demoralized, whoever. I didn't take on their way of life. I kept my bearings in Christ, but I entered their world and tried to experience things from their point of view. I've become just about every sort of servant there is in my attempts to lead those I meet into a God-saved life. I did all this because of the message. I didn't just want to talk about it. I wanted to be in on it. I didn't just talk about it. I wanted to be in on it. So let's talk about peacemakers. You see, Jesus calls his followers to be peacemakers and says that those people will be God's children. In his teaching, he highlights that blessedness and happiness will be found in those who draw closest to the pain index for other people. You see, that's how you know Jesus is not a Christian. Because Jesus actually says that the closest way that we can get to God is to draw closest to the pain in the lives of other people. Jesus articulates to hurting people living on the underside of the Roman Empire who have every justifiable reason to avoid pain at every turn to engage more with those who are in greater pain, and there they will find their true contentment and purpose. You know, I was being sarcastic in saying Jesus is not a Christian just because, and I know not you all's Christianity because you're very spiritual people, but in some of the Christian circles that I belong to, we have a tendency to have our Christianity be a little risk averse in the sense that we want to figure out how can I follow Jesus and toe the line close enough where it does not inconvenience me. I'm willing to go to heaven as long as I could get there sipping my latte while I have my iPad tucked under my arm and I'm text messaging on my iPhone and try not to trip over my MacBook. That was just my confessional. But we are always trying to figure out how do we live in the most risk-averse way possible. Heard a story from a colleague, Jerry, who says that I live in Irvine, the safest city per capita in the United States of America. But that's not enough. I live in a gated community in Irvine, the safest city per capita in the United States of America. That's still not enough. I live in a house with a high-priced burglar system inside a gated community, inside the safest city, United States of America. The joke is that we find ways to be as risk-averse as possible, yet Jesus calls us as peacemakers to engage where there is pain. Jesus actually says, as peacemakers, I want you to go look for the fight. Look for the conflict. Look for the pain. And as you do, there you will find the space to actually see the world that God is making be revealed. That it's in that place, that crucible of the conflict, that you actually see the world that God is making. Let's look at the definitions of peacemaker and peacekeeper, because those are different realities. You see, a peacemaker is one who engages in obvious conflict for the purposes of reconciling the opposing parties, whereas a peacekeeper is one who preserves peace that is already there. The peacekeeper comes, it's not necessarily looking for the conflict, but more wants to maintain the peaceful status quo. But you see, Jesus doesn't teach us, blessed are the peacekeepers, for they will be called God's children. Jesus says, no, I didn't come to the world to keep peace. Jesus says, I came as a peacemaker. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Our love expressed and fueled by the Holy Spirit in our lives is supposed to have a very demonstrative and powerful public witness in the broken spaces and margins of our world. I love Cornel West has this quote where he says, justice is what love looks like in public. That our love should look like something that creates a fair and just world for all. Jesus said in Matthew's gospel, stand up for me against world opinion, and I'll stand up for you before my Father in heaven. If you turn tail and run, do you think I'll cover for you? Don't think I've come to make life cozy. I've come to cut, make a sharp knife cut between son and father, daughter and mother, bride and mother-in-law. Cut through these cozy domestic arrangements and free you for God. Well-meaning family members can be your worst enemies. If you prefer father or mother over me, you don't deserve me. If you prefer son or daughter over me, you don't deserve me. I didn't say it, Jesus did. And when we all get to heaven, we're all going to put Jesus in a timeout and talk to him about a lot of these hard sayings that that Jesus calls us into this space of conflict that we might make the peace. And so it causes us to have to talk about risk. Let's talk about risk. Jesus taught us through his teachings and his life what the heartbeat of the gospel is. It's sacrifice. What makes Jesus' story unique and lifted up amidst a pluralistic society is that he gave his life as a payment for others. And what did he purchase? Reconciliation. Jesus' life is the tangible example of peacemaking. I've heard the discussions over the last few years about the hole in our gospel. Everyone's trying to figure out, what is the hole in our gospel? And how do we fill the hole in our gospel? I submit that the hole needs to be filled with one thing, risk. Since Jesus said that the world that God is making would be found in the very poor, the only way we become aware to this emerging world is to engage with poverty. We must do this as peacemakers who give up any elitism or paternalism that we might carry. We must confront our implicit biases and other things that we have that force us into our corners and cause us to other people that we might see the world that God is making be revealed. Sometimes means we have to put our ballot at risk, our body at risk, that we might see the world that God is making. My risk last year, well, actually, before I go there, I want to touch a little bit more on this idea of peacemaking that leads to risk. I shared earlier about my story with the police department and how I had reasons to distrust them and not work with them, but I had to allow the gospel to push me through that place that I was in. And now I actually train Oakland Police Department officers and work with them. But here's one of the things that I realized, that they have a different view and worldview than I did. So when I walked in with them, I always come in with shoes. And I stand in front of them and I say, shoes. I don't know what it feels like to walk in your shoes. I don't know what it feels like to experience the risks that you take on a daily basis. I don't know what it feels like to leave your home and kiss your kids goodbye, knowing that you may not see them again. I don't know what it feels like to have to make a split second decision on something that you might be judged for the rest of your life about. I don't know what it feels like to walk in your shoes, but I know what it feels like to walk in my shoes. And what I hope is that if I can talk to you about my shoes, you might trust me to talk to me about your shoes, and we can find a way to get your shoes and my shoes on the same road together and walk a journey in the city that we both want to belong to. That peacemaking says one person is not better than the other, but we've got to find a way to listen to one another. We've got to risk a little bit. We've got to humanize one another so we could see the world that God is making. My risk last year was going to Ferguson. I went to Ferguson after we received a call from some colleagues that they needed help for some of us to come and support them and help to support some of the young people and to come and to be the presence of a peacemaking envoy in the streets. And so as we went, I was struck by just the reality of everything that was going on. And when I got out there, even my own trauma was challenged as to whether I was going to allow my old wounds to define how I would respond in that moment. And so I ended up making 3 trips to Ferguson over the course of 60 days and spending a lot of time there building relationships with young people and being in solidarity with them and listening to their pain. One trip, I went and as we arrived I drove across the state from Kansas City. I was there for some other meetings and came to Ferguson and got out of the car, and there was about 150 protesters in front of a police line. And you could tell the emotions were high. And so I jumped out of the car and I went running across the street and I ran right into the crowd, and I saw some of the young folks that I had met from the first time that I was there. And I went and I positioned myself right between the police and the young people, along with about 4 or 5 other faith leaders. And we stood there and put our bodies on the line so that both sides could see if anything is going to happen, it'll happen to my body before it'll happen to yours. And so we stood there in that moment, and I'll tell y'all, that was one of the few times that I felt more afraid than any other time I felt over the last several years. And so we stood there in that moment, and I stood next to a young chocolate sister with beautiful cheeks. And she had tears just flowing down her face. And she was screaming, "I go home happy. I go home sad. You go home happy. I go home sad, you go home happy. You care more about a dog than you do me. I'm a human being. I'm a human being. I'm a human being." I remember looking at her and realizing the depth of pain she was in. Not that that was that officer's reality, but she was in deep, bona fide pain. And I realized in that moment that even myself as a faith leader hadn't been listening well to younger people and to their pain. I was always waiting for them to listen to me and what I had to say. And so we were there in solidarity, and we ended up leading a faith march. I have a quick video that I want you to see.
Because we love the young folk, and we're going to bear witness. We want them to know that there's some older generation, brothers and sisters of all colors, who are willing to put their bodies on the line so that justice can roll down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream.
Are you denying us access to a public building to go request a meeting with the Ferguson police chief? We are not resisting.
Back up. Don't push. Don't push.
Thinking was off of it a little bit, but that ended up being a day where we came, and as we stood in solidarity, we put our clean records on the line, we put our bodies on the line, and I ended up getting arrested. Never been arrested in my life, and there I sat in the back of a paddy wagon for at least an hour and a half, and going through that whole process was so interesting. And subsequently, as my arresting officer was taking me to processing, we were talking and I was sharing my story and I was asking about his story and we were listening to one another. And when we got to the final processing station, he told me, he said, "Man, I wish we could have met under different circumstances. I like you." I said, "I like you too." And then subsequently, I went in, and as I was being processed, my processing officer kept me 30 minutes longer than she was supposed to, and we started talking and engaging, and I started telling her about the community to police relationship building that we do in Oakland and how it's going, and we engaged and engaged, and as I'm sitting there handcuffed to the chair, she told me, she said, "Okay, I have to move you on because I got to put you in jail, but..." She said, "But one thing you have to promise me." And I said, "What's that?" She said, "You got to promise me that you come back to Ferguson." So who would have thought that by stepping into a space and being in solidarity with young people to help make peace with them, then equally getting arrested and then being in police custody, that the police would be asking me to come back? What I'm lifting up for us is this sense is when we are willing to take a little flack and go through a little risk. Now, I've been critiqued by many for going to Ferguson. My theology has been questioned by folks. My ideology has been questioned. I've been named all kinds of different names. But Jesus says, I need people who are willing to serve as peacemakers, who are willing to put your reputation and your body on the line and everything that is valuable to you to lean into the world that I'm making, because I believe that God wants something more than peaceful segregation. Y'all know what peaceful segregation is. A lot of us have it with our neighbors. Your branch is 3 inches over my fence. That God wants more than peaceful segregation, but that he wants what Dr. King talked about, beloved community, the kingdom of God, love-struck integration, that I am willing to keep listening longer than feels comfortable, that we might build the relationship and that we might make the peace. that we as the people of God have the spiritual energy to do not what the media does, that we don't need to just be caricatures of what's broken in our world, but we actually need to be examples and the demonstration of what Jesus looks like in our world. Jesus says again in Matthew's gospel, if you don't go all the way with me through thick and thin, you don't deserve me. If your first concern is to look after yourself, you'll never find yourself. But if you forget about yourself and look to me, you'll find both yourself and me. My friend Bill came with me my last two trips to Ferguson. He's on the picture. We've got one more slide. He's the guy standing there in the middle of the street. Bill, 48-year-old, white brother, former police officer, former pastor, who said, Ben, I've got to come with you back to Ferguson. So he came with me on that second time that I told you about, and I jumped out of the car and ran into the crowd. And I was there for about 10 or 15 minutes, and I started wondering, where's Bill? I forgot about Bill. And it wasn't until I found him in the crowd. He's all right. He's okay. But when we got back to the hotel later that night after being out there on the streets till about 3 o'clock in the morning, we got back to the hotel and we're looking through all the different media sites, see the coverage of CNN and Fox and MSNBC. And this was the cover picture on MSNBC. And I thought it was an interesting metaphor of Bill standing there right in the middle of the street, trying to figure out, I care and I belong, but I don't know where I fit in. I don't know that I could run right there into the crowd with Ben. I don't know that I want to. I don't know that I'll be safe. I don't know what it means for me if I actually run into that crowd. What does that mean for what I believe about police officers that are my friends? What does it mean about what I believe about myself as a follower of Jesus? I don't know. So he was in the middle of the street, and subsequently, step by step, by step by step, he moved into the crowd. And a lot of what enabled him to move into the crowd was the relationship that he and I had. You see, the power of peacemaking calls us to cross the street. I oftentimes say that hope is living in the neighborhood, but it doesn't make it to people's doorstep until we cross the street. That God is actually looking for us to cross the street. And maybe it's not any of the divides and conversations that I've talked about. Maybe it's some different divides and conversations going on in your life. But the power of peacemaking means that we actually begin to engage with those that we've othered, that God might use us as agents of reconciliation, healing, and justice to help make the world that he's making. Dr. King said this quote that I'm going to finish with. He says, I choose to identify with the underprivileged. I choose to identify with the poor. I choose to give my life for the hungry. I choose to give my life for those who have been left out of the sunlight of opportunity. I choose to live for those who find themselves seeing life as a long and desolate corridor with no exit sign. This is the way I'm going. If it means suffering a little bit, I'm going that way. If it means sacrificing, I'm going that way. If it means dying for them, I'm going that way. Because I heard a voice saying, do something for others. We're living in a world where upheaval is a daily. We've got all the reasons to stay out of the game. We've got people that we've othered. Maybe it's gender, maybe it's class. Maybe it's race. But Jesus called MLK to respond in his moment, and I think he's calling us to respond in ours. Now, I don't think that we're potentially going to get another king, but I think we might be able to get 1,000 princes and princesses who would be able to do that same thing in worship for the King of Kings. And so may we lean into the world that God is making. May we be filled with God's grace to do God's will in God's world, to fulfill God's dream. Some next steps I just want to give us. I want to encourage us to see the Selma movie, if you haven't already. See it as a family or with a small group or with a conversation partner that you trust. identify the presence of peacemaking or peacekeeping and what makes them different. Talk about why you respond as a peacemaker or a peacekeeper in the challenges and conflicts that show up in our world or through the media. The second thing I want to offer for you to do is to Google the letter from a Birmingham jail that was written by Dr. King. And maybe take it during one of your times of devotion. Read it, reflect upon it during your private prayer time, and ask God if there might be anything that he might want you to hear or listen to. And maybe follow up with some time with a close friend, a mentor, or a pastor. Volunteer somewhere that pushes up the risk factor. Not 15 notches. I'm not telling you all to come to Oakland and get arrested. But maybe volunteer somewhere that pushes up the risk factor one notch, that has you engage with certain people that maybe you would have othered. And then lastly, engage in dialogue with intention with someone who you know wears different shoes. Could be a business associate, PTA member, maybe you go to school with this person or a neighbor. Ask them if you could hear their story. And don't wait for an opportunity to counter their story with an argument. Just listen and see what journey they have that's led them to where they are. And through all of this, may God cause us to become one body, used in his way to heal our neighborhoods, our cities, our region, our state, and ultimately the nation and the world. Stand with me quickly, if you would. I'm going to take you to tradition that we do at my church tradition. Grab hands with your neighbor. It might be a little sweaty. They're okay. I want you to look at one of your neighbors and tell them, I believe in you. Look at them again and say, God believes in you. Tell them the world needs you. Tell them this is our time. I want to pray for us quickly. Lord, as we hold our neighbor's hand, Lord, we pray that you would fill us with the Spirit of God that gives us the ability to do what we cannot do in our own strength, which is to die for your cause. May you give us the strength to die to ourselves, to die to our fears, to die to our doubts, that we might be raised in new life and the new humanity that comes by way of the Spirit of God. Jesus, thank you for giving your life for us, that we might have redemption, grace, and reconciliation. And Lord, we want to follow your example, that we might give hope to others. Now, as you're holding your neighbor's hand, I want you to squeeze it a little bit. We squeeze into our neighbor's hand the courage that comes from the Spirit of God. We squeeze into our neighbor's hand the faith to believe that they can do something bigger than anything they've ever done. We squeeze into our neighbor's hand the capacity to serve as a peacemaker in God's emerging kingdom. And Lord, as you do all these things, we will be careful to give your name all of the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.